This episode is about the Muslims of Sri Lanka during the time of King Parakramabahu the Great in the 12th century. During his reign from his capital Polonnaruwa, he unified the then three sub-kingdoms of the island, becoming one of the last monarchs in Sri Lankan history to do so. He oversaw the expansion and beautification of his capital, constructed extensive irrigation systems, reorganized the country's army, reformed Buddhist practices, and encouraged the arts. Within the island, he consecrated religious monuments, built hospitals, social welfare units, canals, and large reservoirs, such as the Parakrama Samudra, translated as the Sea of Parakrama in Polonnaruwa. The adage, "Let not a single drop of water go waste into the sea without benefiting the world," as said by King Parakramabahu, is one of his most famous utterances. And as we saw in episode 3 regarding the Arabs' contribution to the Babur civilization of Sri Lanka, it was during King Parakramabahu's reign that this country reached its peak of hydraulic development, irrigation, and agriculture. It was the early Arabs and later on Muslims who established themselves as the traders and settled down in Sri Lanka. These wavers or tanks provided water year-round, increasing agricultural production. Prosperity poured into the country when these Arab traders, working for the Sri Lankan kings, exported the surplus agricultural produce of the hydraulic era to the caliphs and populations of the Muslim empires, and this trade in turn brought great wealth to the Kingdom of Sri Lanka. In the dry zone, agriculture was entirely dependent on irrigation and constant vigilance. Manpower and economic resources were needed to maintain the efficient functioning of the hydraulic system. The surplus wealth came largely from foreign trade, which was in the hands of the Arabs. Most rulers of the Polonnaruwa kingdom followed a vigorous commercial policy, and profits from foreign trade formed a vital section of the prospering Sri Lankan economy during this period. King Parakramabahu even resorted to a war with the kings of Burma in order to safeguard the country's trade interest. With kings like Parakramabahu exerting themselves to improve the export trade of Sri Lanka, the Muslim merchants would have found it very rewarding. In a recent study, R.A.L.H. Gunawardana has suggested that periods of prolific activity in the building of irrigation works in Sri Lanka coincided with the most flourishing periods of trade. The explanation for this is that commercial gain provided the resources for hydraulic engineering. These traders brought to Arabia a wealth of information regarding distant lands. Perhaps arising from it was a serious pursuit of geographical knowledge among the Arabs from the 9th century onwards, and Sri Lanka was well known to these writers. An Arabic geographical treatise of the 12th century AD, which gives some detailed attention to Sri Lanka, is the work of Idrisi. Muhammad al-Idrisi, or simply al-Idrisi, was an Arab Muslim geographer and cartographer who for some time lived in Sicily at the court of King Roger II, who he was a protege or a disciple of. Following the wishes of this king, he compiled his book Kitab Nuzhat al-Mushtaq, the Book of Pleasant Journeys into Faraway Lands, and he created the Tabula Rogeriana, one of the most advanced medieval world maps. this map inspired geographers such as Ibn Battuta and Ibn Khaldun, and was also used by explorers like Christopher Columbus and Vasco da Gama for their discoveries and voyages. It is well worth noting that Idrisi in his writings has mentioned the virtues of a Sri Lankan king who was inclusive with regards to the citizens of this country who belonged to different races. Although Idrisi doesn't mention the name of this king, the dates point to none other than Sri Lanka's famed monarch who ruled for decades, King Parakramabahu I. Sir James Emerson Tennant, who was the colonial secretary of Ceylon from 1845 to 1850, and who was knighted for his literary contributions, writes about Idrisi and Idrisi's mention of Sri Lanka in his book titled Ceylon, Volume 1. Of the Arabian authors of the Middle Ages, the one who dwells most largely on Ceylon is Idris. With regard to Ceylon, his pages contain the oft-repeated details of the height of the holy mountain, the gems found in its ravines, the musk, the perfumes, and the odoriferous woods which abound there. He particularizes 12 cities, but their names are scarcely identifiable with any now known. Idrisi, in his writings, mentions the account of another Arab geographer, namely Abu Zayd, and confirms his account about the toleration of all sects in Ceylon. And Idrisi illustrates it by the fact that of the 16 officers who formed the council of the king, 4 were Buddhist, 4 were Muslims, 4 Christians, and 4 Jews. Tennant informs us about what Idrisi observed about the king of Ceylon as follows. The sovereign, who was celebrated for the mildness of his rule, was assisted by a council of 16, of whom 4 were of the national religion, 4 Christians, 4 Muslims, and 4 Jews, and one of the chief cares of the government was given to keeping up the historical records of the reigns of their kings, the lives of their prophets, and the sacred books of their law. We learn from this reputed scholar that the Sri Lankan monarch was assisted in his government by a council of ministers that included 4 Muslims. Lorna Devaraja too mentions this in her book. Arab authors record that the court of Sri Lanka was particularly noted for its religious tolerance. Idrisi, writing in the 12th century, mentions a council of 16 at the royal court, consisting of 4 Buddhists, 4 Muslims, 4 Christians, and 4 Jews, showing that the people of all faiths were welcome and respected. The council referred to was possibly summoned to advise the king on matters of trade. What this shows is that the Muslims of the country were deemed a very important part and parcel of the population of medieval Sri Lanka. They played a very important role in the import-export trade of the country, exporting local produce like gems, pearls, spices, and elephants in exchange for valuable imports such as horses and other luxuries from the Middle East and Far East. What this also displays is that King Parakramabahu the Great established a cabinet of 16 ministers consisting of 4 persons each of the 4 different faiths, thereby giving equal representation to each faith. The word he used is wazir, which in Arabic means a minister, leaving no doubt as to what Idrisi meant.